Live from a bunker in Taylor, Michigan, here's Banger.
Well, Obama rallies Detroit union workers as physical cliff deadline looms. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another edition of the John Lebang Show. I am your host, John Lebang, on this great beginning of the week.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives.
So, President Obama's latest PR blitz pushing his position in the physical cliff showdown brought him to Detroit today, where he pledged to a union-heavy crowd that he would not compromise on raising taxes for high-income earners. The 20-minute speech before a group of invited-only attendees, appearing to number a few thousand, was the most recent in a string of appearances by the president before the key constituencies seek to bolster support for his stance on raising taxes for high-wage earners in the new year. But the Detroit area appearance, Obama's first trip to Michigan in more than 8 months, carried separate significance for union supporters here who are facing the likelihood that Michigan's Republican governor will sign into law the so-called right to work legislation this week. The law allows workers to unionize companies to not pay dues to their unions, thereby severely cutting the funds that give unions their strength. Well, that's a biased opinion there, sir. What I see it as is, if I don't support a union, why should I be forced to join it? Can you tell me that? But Obama's coming here to Detroit to talk about this physical cliff, right? And I was out driving, and I-94 was shut down at Middle Belt, all the way around, because President Obama just happened to come to town to do this speech. And I thought to myself, I says, why can't Obama just teleconference with these people? If the government is so strapped for money that we're having a physical cliff soap opera, isn't that a waste of money flying in to just do a speech to get support? Couldn't you do that via teleconference? Skype? I mean, get on blog TV there, Mr. President. Do a YouTube video. If President Obama is so worried about the physical cliff, why would he incur all this spending for just him showing up for a speech? Listen, what happens is they have to bring in Secret Service, and the Secret Service shuts down a bunch of stuff, and the police have to be brought in, okay? They block off roads, block off the expressway, and they follow the president, or they lead the president, you know, those things called the motorcade, to his destination. And then they have all this surveillance. Well, we're talking maybe millions of dollars that the government had just spent. So President Obama could come make a speech. Now, excuse me, Mr. President, you know, I do pay taxes, and I do not approve of you wasting millions of dollars to do something you could have done via Skype, teleconference, YouTube. Obama criticized Michigan right-to-work bill. And then the one that's so dear to my heart, this goes to my local school teachers. Taylor schools to close Tuesday for lack of teachers. Oh, yeah. Superintendent says teachers are likely going to be at protests in Lansing over right to work instead of being at school. I think a lot of us would get fired for that, don't you think? Must be nice to be in a union. The Taylor School District will be closed down Tuesday because of the high number of staff that have either called in sick or are taking personal days to attend rallies in Lansing.
Yes, because they love the children so much.
Superintendent Diane Allen told Local 4 there isn't enough teachers to cover classrooms, so all schools will be closed for the day. She said she had heard from the principal about where the teachers were going. Yeah, I think I would be fired. She didn't immediately give an exact number of staff who had called off work. The state and Senate approved bills last week that would prohibit requiring non-union employees to financially support unions at their workplace. Lansing authorities are bracing for an onslaught of protests Tuesday. They have increased police presence and planned road closings and parking restrictions around the Capitol. And let's see. Oh, last week we had the buses from Chicago with the SEIU members coming protesting in Michigan. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Buses were trucked in from Chicago with SEIU members to protest in Michigan. Excuse me, what frickin' business is it of theirs? But none of these unions are affiliated with each other, I'm sure. This is not coordinated, so that way everybody can only take a day off, and if you get enough different unions to participate, you can go down and have people protesting for weeks on end. Oh no, this is not coordinated. Oh no. I mean, really? Unions would coordinate their effort to go protest? Oh, and by the way, these SEIU members who were trucked in from Chicago? Yes, they did. They vandalized the Capitol building because that's the peace-loving left. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's always got to be peace with them, you know. They're not violent at all, no. 8 or 9 guys got arrested, or people got arrested. Mm-hmm. They're not violent. Oh, no. These unions are just worried about everybody else.
Yes, they are.
I find it ridiculous that these unions are all simultaneously heading down there on different days. This is obviously a coordinated effort on the union / left, and it's completely political. We here in Michigan had to put up with a bunch of left-wing stuff on the ballot, which would have made it constitutional, according, you know, Michigan constitutional, that the union would have ultimate power over legislation, and the people said no. Mm-hmm. We did that in the last election, right? We said the hell with you unions. Mm-hmm. So now the unions are all mad because we're moving in the direction to get us away from having to pay union dues to a political hack party that donates or is a wing, or a symbiont of the Democratic Party. People of Michigan said no to the unions. And now that we're just trying to move that forward, the unions are coming in and causing problems. Mm-hmm. Sure. All right, folks, I'm going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. Do we live in a computer simulation?
Oh, Mr. Anderson.
Decades ago, a British philosopher put forth the notion that the universe we live in might in fact be a computer simulation run by our descendants. While that seems far-fetched, perhaps even incomprehensible, a team of physicists at the University of Washington has come up with a potential test to see if the idea holds water. The concept that current humanity could possibly be living in a computer simulation comes from a 2003 paper published in Psychological Quarterly by Nick Bostrom, a philosophy professor at the University of Oxford. In the paper, he argued that at least one of the three possibilities is true. The human species is likely to go extinct before reaching a
post-human stage. In other words, this godlike situation. Kill ourselves off before then. Yeah.
Any post-human civilization is very unlikely to run a significant number of simulations of its environmental history. We are almost certainly living in a computer simulation.
You disappoint me.
He also held the belief that there is a significant chance that we will one day become post-humans who run ancestor simulations is false.
You can't scare me with this Gestapo crap.
Unless we are currently living in a simulation.
I know my rights.
With current limitations and trends in computing, it will be decades before research will be able to run even primitive simulations of the universe.
I want my phone call.
But the UW team has suggested tests that can be performed now or in the near future that are sensitive to constraints imposed on future simulations by limited resources.
Tell me, Mr. Anderson, what good is a phone call if you're unable to speak?
Currently, supercomputers use a technique called LQC, and starting from the fundamental physical law that govern the universe, can simulate only a very small portion of the universe. On a scale of 1/100 trillionth of a meter in a larger than the nucleus of an atom, says Martin Savage, a UW physics professor. Eventually, more powerful simulations will be able to model on the scale of the molecular. Then a cell and even a human being. But it will take many generations of growth in computing power to be able to simulate a large enough chunk of the universe to understand the constraints on physical processes that would indicate we are living in a computer model. However, Savage said there are signatures of resource constraints in present-day simulations that are likely to exist as well as simulations in the distant future, including the imprint of an underlying lattice if one is used to model the space-time continuum.
I'm no longer a member of the continuum. My superiors have decided to punish me.
And punish us as well, it would seem.
The supercomputers performing lattice quantum chromodynamics calculations essentially divide space-time into a four-dimensional grid. That allows researchers to examine what is called a strong force, one of the four fundamental forces of nature and the one that binds subatomic particles called quarks and gluons together into neutrons and protons at the core of the atom. If you make the simulation big enough, something like our universe should emerge. Then it would be a matter of looking into a signature in our universe that has an analog in the current small-scale simulations. Savage and his colleagues of the University of New Hampshire, who collaborated while at the U of W's Institute of Nuclear Theory, a UW physics graduate student, suggests that the signature could show up as a limitation in the energy of cosmic rays.
Ooh, we're getting into Fantastic Four territory now, folks. Oh, yeah.
In a paper they have posted on ARXIV, an online archive for reprints of scientific papers in a number of fields, including physics, they say that the highest energy cosmic rays would not travel along the edges of the lattice in the model, but would travel diagonally, and they would not interact equally in all directions, as they otherwise would be expected to do. This is the first testable signature of such an idea, Savage said. If such a concept turned out to be reality, it would raise other possibilities as well. For example, they suggest that if our universe is a simulation, then those running it could be running other simulations as well, essentially creating other universes parallel to our own. The question is, can you communicate with other universes if they are running on the same platform?
Oh no, now we're moving into the Mayan calendar now, folks.
Russian residents buy up tin goods and matches ahead of apocalypse. Russian residents are buying up cereals, tin meat, and boxes of matches in anticipation of the pending apocalypse. In a widely reported prediction, it has been claimed across the globe that the world will end on December 21st, when the Mayan long count calendar comes to an end. The head of a chain of hardware stores in Siberia told reporters that demand had tripled the prices of candles. People freaking out in Russia. Mayan apocalypse panic spreads as December 21st nears. This is on the Telegraph.
Fears that the end of the world is nigh have spread across the world for only days until the end of the Mayan calendar, with doomsday mongers predicting a cataclysmic end to the history of Earth.
Okay, folks, let's go over something. Now, instead of being so scared for the next couple weeks, worrying about dying and the end of the world and all that crazy jazz, take this chance to live a little. Because if you knew you were going to die in 2 weeks, wouldn't you want to enjoy them? With that in mind, if you knew someone else was going to die in 2 weeks, wouldn't you be extra kind to them? So, let's take these next few weeks and apply that logic. Regardless of whether the world is going to end or whatever, it doesn't matter. What matters is what we do with the time we have. And hopefully, if we're going to die,
we don't have our brains sucked out by the aliens from Mars.
Speaking of aliens, oh, triangular crafts hover over Richmond, Hill, Ontario. A witness in a town of Richmond Hill in southern Ontario, Canada, has reported sighting and triangular craft on 23rd of November. The report has been obtained from a testimonial included in a database of Mutual UFO Network. The witness begins the report by describing the exact location and time of the sighting.
Last night, my husband and I were traveling north towards Sawfield Side Road, north of the Angle Hills, at approximately 6:30. I first noticed the object directly north.
She further tells about the presence of lights in the triangular formation and why she found it hard to determine the exact colors of those lights.
There were lights at each point in different directions, and it was hard to tell the story of the lights because it looked like the colors were changing.
U.S. declaring Syrian rebel group as terrorist body. The Obama administration is declaring a Syrian rebel group with alleged ties to Al-Qaeda as a terrorist organization. It's an effort to blunt the influence of extremists as the U.S. steps up cooperation with the Syrian opposition. The State Department action blocks Abjata al-Nusra's assets in the U.S. and bars Americans from doing business with them. The move hasn't been announced officially, but was included in the Federal Registry on Monday. The department said the group was part of a Al-Qaeda in Iraq. Al-Nusra has claimed responsibility for suicide bombings on Syrian government targets, raising fears of growing Islamic extremists among the opposition. Secretary of State Hillary Rodham Clinton is traveling to North Africa this week to try to bolster moderates hoping to end Syrian President Bashar Assad's regime. So, seems like a little CYA here, doesn't it? So first we're backing the rebels, but now the rebels are part of Al-Qaeda. Keep that one as I read you this next story. U.S. plans for military intervention against
Syria.
Yesterday, military.com reported that 400 U.S. and Dutch NATO troops were already massed on Turkey's Syrian border, readying Patriot missiles 3 days after NATO agreed to deploy the MM-104 Patriot surface-to-air missile system in Turkey. This follows the announcement this week by Germany, which is supplying two of the three missile systems to Turkey, along with one up from the Netherlands, that will be dispatched 170 troops to the Syrian border. U.S. Defense Secretary Leon Panetta and German Foreign Minister Guido Westerwelle both have alleged that the regime of Syrian President Bashar al-Assad is actively considering the use of
chemical weapons
against its opponents, a move defined as a red line by Washington. On Monday, President Barack Obama said the use of chemical weapons is totally unacceptable and would have
consequences.
So now we're being told there's WMDs. I think we heard that before. Syrian Deputy Foreign Minister Faisal Miqdad yesterday reiterated Syrian stresses again for the 10th and 100th time. time that if we had such weapons, they would not be used against our people. We would not commit suicide. And I will step in here again and say this. I agree with that statement in the fact that that would be suicide if Syria were to use it. And I don't think they're going to use chemical weapons, because if they did, the whole world would come down on them. And they're trying to stay alive. They're not trying to make their life any harder. Just saying. The unsubstantiated claims that Syria intends to do so are as transparent a pretext for an act of military aggression by NATO powers as were the lies a decade ago about Iraq.
Weapons of mass destruction.
The U.S. has made extensive preparation for an intervention that has nothing to do with the intelligence it claims to possess regarding
chemical weapons.
Washington has deployed a naval armada off Syrian coast, spearheaded by the Eisenhower Carrier Strike Group, and including an amphibious battle group consisting of the USS Iwo Jima and the USS New York and the USS Gunston Hall, which carry a contingent of 2,500 U.S. Marines. This brings 17 warships, 70 fighter bomber, and 10,000 military personnel within striking distance of Syria, in addition to the Air Force 39th Air Base Wing stationed at the base in Turkey, and tens of thousands of U.S. ground troops deployed in Kuwait, Qatar, and United Arab Emirates and Bahrain. The far more substantial U.S. buildup is in line with plans drawn up by the Pentagon, estimated that a full-scale military intervention against Syria would require 70,000 U.S. troops. Are we ready to go to war? Left out there? Just saying. Okay, they're saying there's WMDs, okay? We were helping the rebels, okay? Now the rebels just haven't been able to beat Assad, okay? So now we call these rebels a terrorist group, and now there's WMDs inside Syria all of a sudden. So the people we're helping are terrorists. You get that, folks?
We can't let the terrorists take over Syria. We can't let that happen. Oh, no. Can't do it. And we can't let Syria use their WMDs.
Isn't that nice, folks? Oh, yeah. All of a sudden, we've got Iraq and Afghanistan, terrorists and WMDs all put into one into Syria. Very convenient. Over to economic news. Deal or no deal, Obamacare taxes poised to hit in January.
Yep. Yes, folks. We're all getting zapped with Obamacare taxes, whether you like it or not.
Hostess maneuver, and that's called bankruptcy, to deprive pensions. Aww.
That's just so bad. I'm sorry.
Oyster Company, Obama administration, faulty science shuts us down. A family oyster business recently shut down by the Obama administration, demanding that the public land on which it operates revert to a wilderness area, is suing the federal government for what they say is an illegal taking of their property. Our family business is not going to sit back and let the government steamroll our community, which has been incredibly supportive of us. Drake's Bay Oyster Company said in a statement, lawyers for the company, which is situated in Drake's Estro, a tidal inlet of Drake's Bay, will ask a judge in the Northern District of California's District Court for an injunction on Friday to block the eviction while the lawsuit progresses. So, the Obama administration is going to put people out of work to protect a wilderness area, but this business has been there for how long? Nice job, Obama. And joining us in the studio, we have our buddy Stone Logic. What's going on, Stoney?
Hey, man, what's going on, dude?
So the governor signs Amendment 64, marijuana officially legal in Colorado.
Yeah, man, that was so cool, man, you know, because, like, you know, they got some really good weed down there in Colorado, man. And so, like, you know, I'm going to go out there, like, next week or something, you know, man, and, like, hang out and, like, smoke down and, like, maybe eat some brownies, you know, man.
So, like Stoney, so what does this, like, mean out there in Colorado?
Well, man, you know, it formalizes the amendment, man, as part of the state constitution, man. And makes, like, legal the personal use and possession and then, like, limited home growing of marijuana under Colorado law, man, for, like, man, you know, like, adults 21 and older, man, you know, because, you know, you can't let the kids be, like, you know, growing weed and all, man, because they don't get the seeds in it, man. They don't know how to pick between the male and the female, and, you know, can't get the seeds in it, man. They just don't have enough experience, man.
That's funny because my dad lives out there and he's like completely against marijuana. I should go visit him and just smoke a joint right there in front of him, eh? What do you think?
Hey, man, you know, I'll come out there with you, man. I know some cats out there, dude. Like, you know, they get the really good stuff, man. It's kind of like that stuff that was like, you know, you get up in Seattle, man. You know, it's like green with the purple and all that. Man, you just kind of like smoke it down and you get all high and, you know, just kind of like far out, man. You know, just kind of want to party down, man, and just kind of do your thing and, like, you know, you don't just get high, man. You know, and I just, like, you know, ever since Hostess went out, man, though, you know, it's been hard to find some munchies, man, you know, because everybody bought up the Twinkies, man. I had to go on eBay, man, and buy the last box of Twinkies, man, for, like, $500, man. They kind of bummed me out, man, you know. So you know, now I'm, like, switching over, you know, on my snacks, man. I'm just going to get, like, eat the goldfish and the Cheetos, man, because, you know, it's good. You can lick the cheese off your fingers, man. It's kind of cool there, man, so.
All right, well, Stoney, thanks for coming in. I appreciate it. We'll talk to you again soon.
All right, man. We'll talk to you, man.
And with that, folks, another wonderful edition of the John Lebang Show has concluded. Tune in again tomorrow for more crazy wackiness and hilarity, as well as plenty of political war talk and all the crazy stuff that happens on this planet called Earth.
And hopefully the aliens don't come and suck my brain out.
This is John LeBay, and I am signing out.